G'day, I'm James. I think most everyone has heard of the quadratic equation for solving quadratic equations, but what if you've heard of the Citardauq equation for solving quadratics? It goes as follows. If ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0 is the quadratic equation you'd like to solve, then the solutions apparently are x equals negative 2c over b plus the square root of b squared minus 4ac, or negative 2c over b minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac. The Citardauq formula. Wow, very curious. Just to practice it, let's do an example. Let's solve, say, x squared minus 3x plus 2 equals 0. So a is 1, b is negative 3, and c is 2. Then according to the Citardauq formula, x would have to be negative 2c, negative 4, over b, negative 3, plus or minus, I split it out that way, it could be plus or minus, b squared, 9 minus 4ac, 9 minus 8, so plus or minus the square root of 1, which is 1. So it's either negative 4 over negative 3 plus 1, or negative 4 over negative 3 minus 1. Negative 4 over negative 2, so it's either 2, or negative 4 over negative 4, or 1. So apparently, x is either 2 or 1, and you can check that's correct. 2 squared, 4 minus 6 plus 2 is 0. X equals 2 is the solution. 1. 1 squared minus 3 plus 2 is 0. Yes, 1 is indeed a solution. The Citardauq formula. Very, very weird. Let me derive it for you right now. This is actually valid. It does solve all quadratic equations. Well, there's a little caveat here about zero solutions, but let's talk about this. In fact, here's the way to derive it. Let's split into two cases, the case where c is either 0 or c is not 0. In fact, the not 0 case is easiest to do first. So let me derive the formula under the assumption c is not 0. So if c is not 0, then I know that x equals 0 is not a solution. I can't have 0 plus 0 plus c equals 0 under that assumption. So I know my solutions are guaranteed to be non-zero. So, assuming this, I know I've got non-zero solutions, so let's work with that. So let's divide this equation through by x. In fact, let's divide it by x squared, because I know x is not going to be zero in the work I'm doing. So divide through by x squared, and I get the equation a plus b x over x squared, so it's b times 1 over x, plus c over x squared, that's c 1 over x squared would still be 0 over x squared is 0. So there is a modified version of my quadratic equation. In fact, it's its own quadratic equation in the variable 1 over x. C 1 over x squared plus b 1 over x plus a equals 0. So by the standard quadratic formula, 1 over x must be negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac. Watch out, that's the new a and that's the new c, minus 4ac. Oh, which is still ac, okay. All over twice a, but watch out here, the a is a c over twice c. So x must be the reciprocal of that, 2c over negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac, or multiply the top and bottom by minus sign, minus, plus, minus, plus, which is indeed those two solutions. All right, so that's the case when c is not 0. Yes, this is in fact just a variation of the quadratic formula. When c is 0, then things are interesting. Let's look at that. If c is 0, then I'm dealing with the equation ax squared plus bx equals 0, and I get that x equals 0 is indeed a solution to the equation. And in fact, look at this. This part here, if c is 0, I get 0 on the top, and I get b plus, well, the 4ac is 0, b plus b on the bottom indeed gives me 0 as a solution. It will give me x equals 0. This part of the Citardauq equation is strange. When c is 0, it wants to be 0 on the top, and it also wants to be 0 on the bottom. So actually, calculus students, you could take the limit of this formula, this version of the formula right here, as c tends to 0, and use L'Hopital's rule to see if it gives you the other solution to that quadratic. And it does. And it does. All right, the Citardauq formula. Very strange, very unusual, and then it brings up a whole host of pedagogical questions. So let me clean the board, and I want to raise four issues about this. Should it be used in the classrooms? Let's talk about it, but I'll be back in a moment. Okay, so what is the place of this strange, bizarre formula for the classroom practice? What's going on here? What should we do with this? Well, some people might object to it completely for the following reason. I mean, look at the example I did. I solved x squared minus 3x plus 2 equals 0, and it does seem a very bizarre, strange way to get the answers 2 and 1. Particularly because this equation here is so simple to solve. In fact, you can see it factors. You see it factors as x minus 1 times x minus 2 equals 0, in which case x equals 2 and x equals 1 are obviously the solutions. Why go through all this bother? That raises an interesting question. What are we ultimately doing by teaching quadratics in the classroom? Is our goal just to get answers to quadratic equations as fast as possible? And if that's the goal, then what are we doing? Let's be citizens of the 21st century and do the most intelligent thing to get answers with speed. Namely, use the tools of the 21st century. Let's just type in our quadratics into Wolfram Alpha or something. It'll give us the answers, do it much more accurately than we would ever do, and we'll do much more speedily than ever. So if the goal is just to get answers, this is the smart way to go. Which then clearly means the goal is not to get answers. That's not the point of this whole unit. Obviously, it must be about the thinking, the understanding, and the problem solving going on. So we're teaching quadratics about problem solving and thinking. Great. Then comes the question, well, should have students know this formula? Should they memorize it? Should they memorize the quadratic formula? In fact, that then brings up the issue, what's the role of memorization in a unit on quadratics? Should we memorize the quadratic formula? Good question. And that's going to have different calls and different curricula. Some curricula say, yes, you must memorize. Some curricula say, you actually don't need to, because you actually understand what's going on, that the quadratic formula is just a matter of completing the square, literally drawing a picture of a square and completing it, then everything just falls into place by common sense and following your nose. So, you know, the question of memorization comes up, the Citardauq formula. Clearly you don't want to memorize that, but, you know, raises that issue. The other issue that might come up is, well, okay, maybe this is fun because it's quirky. Obviously, it's quirky and strange and therefore, to my sensibilities, appealing. But maybe it helps actually teach algebraic facility. So it's maybe not an exercise in quadratics per se, but an exercise in just practicing algebra because of the following reason. There's another way to derive the Citardauq formula. Take the standard quadratic equation. So here's ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0. And the standard quadratic formula for that is negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac all over 2a. So clearly the formula was in my head after all. Okay, so look at that. And let's do something what seems radical to most curricula. So most curricula for centuries have been saying, please never write square roots on the bottom, always have square roots on the top. If ever you have square roots on the bottom line, just please rationalize the denominator and put the square roots upstairs. But let's be counter to that. There's nothing mathematically wrong to say you can't just put square roots on the bottom if you wanted to. Let's rationalize the numerator. And if you rationalize the numerator, and here's a good exercise in algebra, what you do is you multiply the top by the conjugate, so it'd be minus b, then minus plus, the other way around, b squared minus 4ac, and balance it with the same thing on the bottom, b squared minus 4ac, scrunchy writing, but hopefully you know what I'm talking about. Actually do the algebra, expand the top, expand the bottom, and lo and behold, out comes the Citardauq formula. By the way, have you figured out what the name is? All right, okay, maybe this is good for just an exercise in an algebraic facility. It's just quirky, it's appealing, and you can practice algebra. And you can do bold things like rationalize the numerator, which actually has a purpose in this case. But actually, the other thing about the Citardauq formula, it does have an actual context and value and meaning. People don't realize that mathematics is a very human story, and every statement is within a context, has a purpose, has a human story behind it, and there's a human value to this particular formula. And it comes up in the following context. So now, our computers, all these things in here, cannot store infinitely long decimals. They must truncate decimals at some point, which means they're always dealing with rounding errors. So when you do a computation, the computer has to do some rounding errors. You can only store finitely decimal places, and those errors might build up. And so sometimes in solving a quadratic equation, if you're going to round a particular square root, you're going to be worried about what those errors are going to do to the final answer. And it turns out in certain cases, the Citardauq formula is much better for handling rounding errors than the standard quadratic formula. In fact, let me give you an example. Let's do this one. X squared minus 6x plus 1 equals 0. You can check by whichever means you like, quadratic formula, completing the square literally, that has two solutions. X is 3 plus the square root of 8, or x is 3 minus the square root of 8. And it's the second one that's interesting, because it's nearly 3 minus the square root of 9. It's nearly 0. In fact, when I worked it out, I got, when I did it, about 1715, I think it is. All right, so it's close to 0. It's a small positive number. Now, the computer cannot store the value square root of 8 or infinitesimally long places. It has to do some rounding. So let me show you what happens if I round the square root of 8 to some other number and try to get this answer that's close to 0. So I'll do a really bad approximation. I'll just round the square root of 8 to one decimal place. So let's approximate root 8 as 2.8. It's 2.8 something something something. I'll just chop it off as 2.8. Now, the quadratic formula actually gives this answer, in which case I'm doing some rounding in how I'm storing the square root of 8. It'll actually present to me on the screen that x will have to be 3 minus 2.8. It'll tell me it's about 0.2, which is actually close-ish. But here's what I'm going to invite you to do. Apply the Citardauq formula to these particular numbers. A is 1, B is negative 6, C is 1, and you'll see that it gives you x is about 0.1724, I think it was. I did it? Yes, 1724. And look, that's much closer to the true answer. Having the square root approximations down the denominator actually handled the errors better. In fact, it's very good when you've got answers that are very close to zero, that the Citardauq formula will give you approximations, give you final answers, will the errors much more contained than the quadratic formula. So there is a context for this that's of value and of meaning. Like all of mathematics, there's always a context for things, and one should always ask, what's the context here? What's its purpose? How does it help me think through stuff? What's its nuance? What's its ambiguity? What's its play? What's its fun? What's its joy? Anyhow, I love the Citardauq equation because it's quirky and also because of all the issues it raises. Have fun with it.